I'll just yell for a moment, and then it'll get super loud. Okay, so the CryptoPunks, what are they? First of all, it's like so cool to have a room full of people that I don't have to start with, like, what is the blockchain? Like, what is the what's computers? So it's nice to start from sort of, we're all at the same level here, and we can all talk about this as like what's coming next for art and stuff like that on this thing. So I'll give you sort of the overview of what's different about this project. It's 10,000 24 by 24 characters. Each one is unique. So each one is different. And if you're wondering, like, how do we verify that they're all different, we just used a computer to do that. We have a computer. So and you can get them for free. Initially, we kept some of them, and then the rest of them we just gave it out. So something like 9,000 were available. You could just pay the transaction fee. After that, after they were all claimed, then you had to get them from someone else. You had to buy them or sell them or put a bid on. So, as far as we know, it's the first digital collectible on Ethereum. I'm saying that now here so that if I'm wrong, someone will certainly correct me afterwards. But as far as we know, as far as we can tell. This is what they look like. You get a sense of the variety there. There's a couple hundred of them. There's a whole bunch of different possible attributes you can see amongst all the punks there. That's all of them. That's all 10,000 in a square. And this is the image that is referred to by the contract. This is the composite image of every punk. This is what they look like zoomed in, and then you can get a sense of how the variety is generated. So there's actually a generator algorithm that it takes sort of base heads and applies all these different configurations and then verifies that that configuration doesn't exist in the set already and then adds it to the set. So we were working on that for a while, and you know, John was mainly doing that and was improving it, adding stuff, adding pipes and things like that. And then eventually, like, at one point we ran it and that was it. And we were done. The set was set. We put it in the contract, put it on the blockchain, and that was the end of it. So what that gives you are these attributes. So this is punk 9609. Male with a cigarette, classic shades, earring, and a mohawk, handsome fella. And you can see on the right here the different sort of rarity of these attributes. So that's part of this whole thing. Like, earrings are surprisingly common. Almost a quarter of all punks are wearing earrings. But, you know, classic shades, a little more rare. Stuff like that. There's also a special category, three special categories of punks, and these are a different face type. So there are zombies, apes, and aliens, and they are in these proportions. So there are 88 zombies, 24 apes, and 9 aliens. And so this was partially random. We didn't determine there would be 9 aliens. We left there, but we had sort of like the ratios in mind, and we sort of built all this in from the start, because we were hoping to kind of get a little bit of the collectible feel in there as well, like things that you could kind of get into. People, we talked a little bit about this previously, but so people get super into like clown hair or something like that, you know, like, which I think might even be true. So the first version of this was the first Solidity contract we ever wrote. We took the ERC-20 contract, which is designed to have certain divisible tokens, and we turned it into indivisible unique tokens. And ERC-721 is partially based on the changes we made to ERC-20. The first version allowed you to offer a punk for sale and buy it from that person if it was for sale, but it did not allow bidding or anything. And we did not know about Web3 at this point. We were just like, put up the address on the website, like the contract address, like, just go there, man, like type in what numbers you want. It was like kind of a terrible idea because people were like making mistakes, they were putting too much money in, they were putting like the wrong index in and stuff. But as soon as we released it, people told us like, dude, there's like a thing to make websites for this. Matter. So we launched this on June 9th of last year. And the reception we thought was like, this is pretty cool, right? These guys look cool. They're on the contract. You can own them for real. Like, let's put it, you know, on Reddit. I'm sure it'll do well. And it did like okay on Reddit. Like a few people. And these things are free too, right? So I'm not asking a lot here. But like, you know, like I would say like 20 punks got claimed. Somebody showed up and got all the aliens. The Ethereum-based project could change how we think about digital art. And we're like, oh yeah, that's what we should have said. We should have said we're going to change digital art, and then everyone would be like, oh man. So they read this, and they're like, oh my god. So it went crazy. It went from like, you know, I think something like 30 punks had been claimed, including all like a bunch of the rare ones, to like within 24 hours, like the transaction rates went up, and people were going crazy, and they were all gone within 24 hours. And That was cool. That was super cool. Because when we started this, we didn't even know if anybody would care at all. Like, at first it felt like, oh my God, we have 10,000 of these things, and people have taken 30. It's going to be stupid, right? But then they all went, and we were like, okay, so that's cool. Like, now they have them. But would anyone not get one for free? But that happened almost immediately. Like, someone sold one for $1, you know? And then someone's like, oh, you spent $1 on that? Like, oh, then I guess $10 isn't that unreasonable for this thing that I really want. Then it was $100, then we saw like 300, then we saw 1,000. It was like, it just ramped right up. As soon as the supply was gone, as soon as everything, the free stuff was gone, everybody jumped on it. So for a little while, we were the third largest gas consumer on the network. And then suddenly an alien sold for 10 Ether. At this point, that was almost $3,000, if you remember those days way back then. Now, it's fun to look back on that because we're all billionaires. So it's easy and nice to look back on the simpler times. But at that point, 10 Ether, $3,000 was like a few weeks ago, that was like, you know, ping files on a laptop. It's like, this is crazy. Like, people are, and it was like this bootstrapping of value that was happening, right? It went from free to $1 to $3,000. It was like, it was crazy. Then we found out there was a bug in the contract. So we just right when we were like, it's working, it's so insane, this is crazy. We found out that the money would go back to the buyer. So yeah, I got the alien and I got the $3,000. That would be a big deal. So you're like, I gotta tell you, like, I've written a lot of software over the years, and that was like one of the worst feelings I've had, because I mean, this is so different. This was like an early and super hard lesson to learn, but I'm glad we got it out of the way then, was that you can't do the normal stuff. You can't be like, yeah, it's cool, like we'll fix it later. Like, so that was a super painful thing. We thought we had blown it. Like, we thought, like, well, that's it. You know what I mean? Like, we could maybe fix this, but how? And then would anyone, you know, follow us? So the two options basically at that point were, like, totally new contract, migrate all this ownership over to that, start again on this fresh contract, undo the broken sales. Or, and then there were some purists arguing for, like, no, we need another contract on top of that that would refer to this, and you would buy and sell with that. It was, like, a little complicated. And we were like, no, it's early enough here. Like, let's just do option one. But this was controversial at the time. There were some people that were saying that this was the wrong thing to do. And we didn't really know, because there's this whole question of, like, what do you own? Like, and so these people were saying, no, the thing I own is in the first contract. Like, if you go to another contract, you've blown this whole thing. It doesn't work anymore. And we were like, well, it's just going to suck. Like, it doesn't make sense to make something that sucks. So let's just do it and hope for the best. So we made CryptoPunks version 2. And even though we had just gotten our ass kicked by this bug, we decided to increase the complexity of the contract.
We added bidding, which seemed like it was important. I think my mic went out. Is that true? Yeah, just take away that.
Okay.
Is this working?
I think all microphones. Hello? So we decided we needed bidding. Like, that was the missing component here. You could offer things for sale, and you could buy them, but you couldn't indicate serious interest. So we added bidding, and the way bidding works is that you have to put the money in the contract. It's an escrow, so there's money sitting in the contract waiting for you to claim. So we did that, and then we had all these transactions we had to do. We had to write all the data from one contract to another. And we were operating then at $300 Ether at 4 Guay gas prices. Cost us $600. Took us like 2 days. Now that would be about $24,000. So there's like sort of a problem currently in that we wouldn't have been able to do it. Basically, we wouldn't have been able to afford it. So there's something to figure out there. But we survived it, and people made the transition. The website switched over, and basically people redid the sales. Like, we were wondering, like, was $3,000 for an alien, like, was that, like, sort of, the guy was a bit drunk and he regrets it? Or, you know, he redid it immediately. He was worried that the guy wouldn't resell him the alien. He was, like, worried he wouldn't get to do that again. We were like, awesome. So it started working again. And then we started improving the website. We created this Web3 thing. We added buttons so you could make offers, bids, and so on right on the website. Your, you know, address is there and so on. Full transaction history for every pump, which is sort of a cool thing in terms of an art thing. Like, there's always these questions of, where did this come from? Is it legitimate? Well, here's the full history of everything that's ever happened to each one of these 10,000 bumps. We had searching, so people could get super I want a male with a mohawk or a hat and plastic shades. Well, there you go. Okay, you got 57 of those guys. And also we did a breakdown of price. A lot of this was based on people asking us for this, like, what are the attributes, how rare are they, and what is the average price for attributes? So I pulled this like a couple days ago. So you can see the average sale price for an alien is now 9.14 ether. Apes at 4.6 and zombies at 1.48. But there's a whole list below this you can scroll. And there's a whole camp, by the way, of people who are calling these special types, aliens, apes, and zombies, not the most valuable kinds. It's actually people that have no attributes. There's only 5 of them, they say, are the most rare. Who am I to say, one way or the other? So those guys sell for pretty high amounts as well. We made a chat room on Discord. There's a bot that announced everything that happened on the network. So you can see what's going on all the time, and that sort of drives in, because everything that has this picture attached to it, you're like, oh man, that kind of awesome. Like, I spent $30 on that, or $16,000. So this is the story here of the guy who got those 7 aliens, he recently did the highest sale. He sold his last alien to the one on the far right with the pipe, which sold for 12 ether, which at the time was $16,000. Who knows, man? I haven't checked this morning, but this is how much he's made. He claimed every pump he got for free, and he's made 105 ether selling our pumps. What were we thinking? Why did we give them away? I don't know. So the story for this dude was that he was on vacation, and so people were putting these crazy bids, you know, 5, 6, 10 ether, and he wasn't claiming them. We're like, what the hell? Like, is this guy holding out for big money? But then he showed up, like, after 3 days, and was like, I'm backpacking in, like, Sri Lanka or something. Like, this is fantastic. I'm accepting all these bids, and I'm extending my trip 2 weeks. So that's what he did. He just got a bunch of money while he was backpacking, and then, like, 2 weeks later, he came back and did it again. So his total haul, this number, 126 grand, is probably not the amount of, like, actual U.S. dollars he got out of it, because I think he's been backpacking, man. So he needed money. But it's pretty high. Like, it's a fair amount of money. And it's cool. Like, honestly, I was joking earlier, but it's like, this is part of the cool thing. It's like, we wanted other people to have these crazy things happen to them as a part of this. Like, it's enough for us just to see this whole thing work. Probably 120,000 plus. Who cares, right? Community, stuff that people have made that's cool. So one of the questions is, how decentralized is it if most of the transactions happen on our website? If that goes down, what happens? Well, they made another website where you can buy and sell pumps. It's called pumpstash.com. So now really it is the case that we don't control at all how you buy and sell these pumps. CryptoPunks.com. This is the one true and only objective valuation formula, as I described in the panel, on CryptoPunks.com, and you can see the orders and different sortings and stuff like that. People are super into this, and it's awesome. It's really cool. Punkish Normalities Exposed is it's stories and backgrounds and bios for each punk that people can add to, which is pretty cool. There's physical paintings now happening. We're going full circle based on the CryptoPunks painted by CryptoPunk Art, if you want to follow that, which is really cool. This thing was awesome. And also famouspunks.com, which is a website where people find punks that look like famous people and put them up on the site, which I for example, free. Series would be more
That's $100,000 for anyone. You know, the price is $100,000.
So what's special about the pumps? What's different about them even? It's a fixed supply. There's 10,000 at the start. There can only ever be 10,000. Each one is unique, and we can't control it. We have no control over the contract itself, which is kind of dangerous because you saw what happened when we made a mistake. We couldn't stop. We thought there was going to be a lot of problems. But now that it's sort of battle tested, it's done a lot of transactions, then it's cool. Like, we can't take away your pumps. We can't tell you. You can't sell them anymore, stuff like that. And then there's this question that's been coming up, which is like, what do you own? Like, we have this image, we own something on the blockchain, but what can I do with this image? And we're trying to figure that out with a lawyer, a copyright lawyer named Eric Adler. And we're working on a few different options, which we're gonna release open source, which the standard art sort of ownership model is like the artist owns the copyright and you own this physical piece of art. And then we're gonna do a couple more options here that you guys are welcome to examine and maybe adopt for your projects, but a license grant, which is you retain a copyright, but the owner, current owner of each piece has a copyright license to do whatever they want, but only that person. So in our case, a lot of people are asking, can I make shirts and sell? Would be like the most radical version of this where they actually own the copyright and the creator did no longer own it. So the little open source this, once we figure out the details of that, people can kind of discuss and modify. And since we're all here, and this is like a rare opportunity for everybody who's working on this stuff. We've been getting asked these questions a lot of like, what is all this stuff? And it's kind of a cool opportunity for all of us to think about it, maybe define some of these things. And at first I would always be a little sheepish about it. I'm like, I don't know, like it's, I mean, it's certainly not, you know, art in the sense of what's on the wall and so on, but I'm starting to kind of come around to the idea that it has these upsides that may make it different and better in very specific ways. So you can't put it on your wall, although maybe with the picture frames we're seeing today with Miro, that could get addressed, which is pretty awesome. And you kind of can't understand it, was the previous problem with that sort of getting mitigated as well. People kind of get this. But the upside is you can buy and sell with anyone in the world instantly. And I typed this in, no galleries, no commissions, no permission. And I was like, that sounds awesome. Like a t-shirt. But that is kind of true. Like, you don't need to get permission to display your work to hopefully sell it and then give away 50, 30%, whatever it is. The crypto pumps contract, by the way, takes no commissions. It's just you sell it, you keep all the money. More downside for us. Upside, no, you know, lots of storage, you know, no storage needs and so on. And the fact is that when people doubt, like, is this real? Like, people already assign value, real money value, to weird stuff like skins and video games that they don't even really own, and loot boxes, they pay money for that, and coins, and, you know, whatever, Farmville, stuff like that. So we're like, we're just a way better version of that, at least, right? If you can actually sell the thing, and like the, you know, Blizzard can't tell you you can, stuff like that. So there's a lot of really cool stuff about this. And now, while you're all here, I'm going to announce the pump raffle winner if John has sent me. If John has run the contract, let's find out. Yes, he has. And now, the whole point for me doing this, I'm going to read out an entire Ethereum address very soon. Actually, he sent me the short form. So the winner of that pump, which I should have put a picture on here, but there's flyers around, is 0x28F4429B and a bunch of junk. So is that really someone who won it? Do you know if you won it or not? Well, we'll figure it out. But anyway, we'll transfer it to you shortly. I think that's it. Yeah,
cool.
Thank you.
We're going to do a couple questions. Great talk. Glad to hear you don't regret a thing. And we'll start with Kieran from Decentraland.
Hey, so I wanted to make sure I heard this correctly. You said this was the first Solidity contract that you guys wrote.
Yeah.
Was this project?
Yes, that's true. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
What sort of tips would you give to people that want to try something like this on their own?
The tips are pretty specific. So the there's no tasty backsies on the blockchain. So you've got to get it right. The testing is super important. Like our mentality is always we do lots of weird side projects and it's all like, I don't know if anyone's going to care, right? So let's just throw it out there and find out. But you kind of can't do that with this. You can't iterate on some parts of this. So you have to really get part of it right. That doesn't mean you have to kill yourself and like never release it, but it just means like you should get a second opinion on it, write unit tests, and actually just run through it all on test net and just be comfortable say.
So I do have a question I wanted to start off first by letting you know that we I'm with Curio Cards. We did an art show about like a year and a half ago, and we launched our first Curio art in May on Ethereum.
Oh, no.
So you asked, so I just wanted to let you know. I had to check because I wasn't sure. I was like, well, that's the exact same. Yeah.
Okay, you know, we were the second. I'm going to edit the slides now.
Certainly the most popular.
It's like, it was. That's why I did that here. Was like, let's just say it and find out, because there's not going to really be another opportunity like this to really find out.
And if anyone was before May, I'd love to know.
Yeah, right now, you're going to get burned.
My question was, the 10,000 that you kept, did you pick those out, or was this a random sampling?
We kept the first 1,000. So, not, no. And it was like, we didn't even look into what it was in there, so there was only one alien. And it's like, super dumb. Like, why did we keep, like, more aliens? I guess getting sadder and sadder while I'm up here. Yeah, we just kept the first 1,000 because we were like, we don't want to charge money for them. We don't want to charge fees for the thing. So what can we do just in case it, like, we're going to feel super dumb if we don't keep something? So we just kept some of it. But the cool part is that we're on the same side. We're just up owners now, so we're on the same side as everybody else if we want it to be popular and all that stuff. So, okay, awesome.
So you mentioned legally you would have the ability for people to, say, print a shirt that would have their CryptoPunk on it. What would happen if somebody created a shirt that had a CryptoPunk on it and then transferred ownership of the asset? Is that shirt then resellable? Like, what are the rules there? That's just...
What are you doing to me here, dude? Look, this is part of the... This is why this thing isn't done. Like, this copyright lawyer is getting crazy. Like, he did a contract and he's like, wait a minute. This doesn't work. So this is part of like what that exact question is one of the things we're still figuring out, like what happens. Certainly I don't think, I know I'm not a lawyer, but it doesn't seem like you'd be able to sell the shirt anymore, but could you keep it? Like, do we have to build that into the actual contract? I'm not sure, but yeah, that stuff like that is like exactly the problem. Do I think?
Yeah, one last question and then we're gonna do a panel segment.
I'm just wondering, when you own a punk, do you own